There's nothing more American than PBS. It's a safe place where kids learn and grow, and where grown-ups are informed, entertained, and inspired. PBS is one of America's greatest resources for 50 years strong, and PBS needs your help to keep going for another 50.
We will have done a great service.
For our future. Visit ProtectMyPublicMedia to learn more, because there's nothing more American than PBS.
There are still a number of questions about the weather forecasts and why there weren't better warning systems that could have possibly saved lives. Our Deema Zein spoke earlier with Matthew Cappucci. He's senior meteorologist for MyRadar.com, and she began by asking him about the origins of the storm itself and why it dumped so much water.
We knew that we had ample moisture in place, absolutely tropical moisture content in the atmosphere. Part of the reason for that was last Monday, Tamaulipas, Mexico got hit by Tropical Storm Barry. Barry moved inland, dissipated, and then left this big blob of humidity that eventually wafted north into Texas. So we knew the antecedent atmospheric conditions favored very heavy rain, but we didn't see much of a trigger. And so that's why even more than 12, 24 hours out, yeah, we thought there could be some isolated flooding, but we didn't think we'd see anything more than like 6-7 inches, never mind a foot and a half of water. What wound up happening, though, was that as we headed towards Wednesday and Thursday, dying thunderstorms in West Texas left something called an MCV, or a mesoscale convective vortex, like this leftover whirlpool in the atmosphere, this little teeny eddy. And this invisible eddy, this little corridor of spinning air, parked over Texas Hill Country and did two things. Number one, it helped focus moisture. It gathered storms and really served as like the local trigger to get storms going. And it wasn't moving, so those storms anchored in place. And the other thing too, this thing was pulling in moisture from the south. So you had an uninterrupted supply, a fire hose of tropical moisture from the Gulf that was aimed directly into these stagnant storms. And it's July. The upper level winds are very weak. The jet stream has retreated all the way to Canada. So there's nothing to move these storms along either. And so you got downpours lasting 6, 7, 8 hours, dumping 3 inches per hour. Very quickly, some folks saw a foot to a foot and a half worth of water.
Was the storm actually what meteorologists thought that it would be, or did it move in a direction that they didn't even expect it to move?
We knew the potential was there for some high-end flooding. We didn't necessarily think the storm would stall for as long as it did. And I think that's when things quickly became problematic. And it was apparent right around midnight, 1 a.m, as you headed into the 4th of July, that something very bad was happening. But by then, even though they were updating the forecast, they were issuing the warnings, a lot of folks were asleep. And so even though the warnings went out and made folks' cell phones squeal and trigger the wireless emergency alerts with the emergency alert system, I think a lot of people just had gone to bed not thinking much was going to happen. And when they woke up, it was a completely different story. There's no good way for a scientist or a communicator to convey a low probability, high impact event. And so I think the forecasts were basically, yeah, there could be some flooding. There could be some locally bad flooding. It wasn't until midnight into very early on the 4th of July when warning operations really were like, the you know what's hitting the fan. This is, you know, going to be a catastrophe. So the warnings were good. The forecasts were flawed. The other frustrating thing, too, has been people trying to use this for political advantage. People saying, oh, you know, Doge cuts caused this flood. No. Typical National Weather Service forecast office staffing is like 2 to 3 meteorologists for this overnight shift. They had 5 in place at the Weather Service in Austin, San Antonio. They were staffed up. They were doing their thing. They knew in advance what was coming, and they had folks there doing the job. Staffing was not an issue. If anything was an issue, the imperfect forecast going in may have been degraded by the reduction of weather balloons over parts of the Great Plains and the Midwest. You have fewer balloons going up to get data because of budget cuts. Then you have less data going into weather models and less accurate weather model simulations. So that may have been a factor, but that's something we have to sort of iron out a little more.
What can you tell people as a meteorologist on the situation and how it could be prevented and what really went wrong?
This absolutely could have been prevented. It doesn't take 3 hours to get to higher ground. A lot of folks had 2 to 3 hours warning. Many of the fatalities were children. There needs to be a responsible adult who is making these decisions and keeping abreast of the weather. There needs to be a plan in place ahead of time. Every school, every camp in America should have a NOAA weather alert radio and have a plan for any type of alert that can come their way. And so few people do. And until we live as a more weather-ready society with these plans, taking these steps, listening to the warnings, I don't think anything's going to change.
And this is always a question that is to be asked when big weather events like this occur. But was climate change a factor to the size of this storm?
So that's a good question. People always ask about climate change. What I'll say is this. No event is caused by climate change. There will always be floods in Flood Alley in Texas, sporadically every couple years. The atmosphere does have a greater capacity to hold a little more moisture these days because as the environment warms, the air is like a sponge, you add a little more moisture. For every degree Fahrenheit the air temperature warms, the air can hold 4% more water. And so that may have led to a bit extra water coming down with this episode. But I think trying to connect it to climate change is challenging, just given this was very unfortunate meteorology, very unfortunate and coincidental ingredients coming together. And that will always be a thing. Natural disasters will always happen. It's only natural. And so even though climate change is raising the ceiling a little bit, this was very much a natural disaster.
Well, that was NewsHour's Deema Zein speaking earlier today with meteorologist Matthew Cappucci. Meanwhile, just a short time ago, Texas Governor Greg Abbott was asked about problems with flood warnings on July 4th. In a testy exchange with reporters, the governor said he was not focused on blame, saying he would focus on solutions and the future instead.